around. My name is Vasilis Fuskas, and I'm the director of STAM. STAM stands for the Center for the Study of States, Markets, and People. And here we're based at the UEL Royal Docks School of Business and Law. We are in an interdisciplinary center. We have many PhD students pursuing work, interdisciplinary work in the field of, you know, political economy, international relations, human rights, etc. We have today, this event is arranged and co-organized with EMAR Foundation, which I just found out is it's a Turkish acronym. It's the Eastdale Foundation for Labor Research, and the president of that foundation, Ismail Yugakan, also welcomes interns, students. Unfortunately, we don't have students, but we good to know, since we have UEL here in Russia, so they're looking forward to have some of our students in their foundation, which is a charity, right, as well, to work for them as interns. So I'll tell my students, I put on the Moodle and this can be sorted. Now, I think Ismail wants to say a few words about his foundation and what they're doing, and then we can continue with our speakers.
Yeah, my name is Ismail Büyükökan. I am Turkish. I've been here for over 34 years. A couple of years ago, a small core group of Turkish progressives, we established a place called Eastdale Foundation for Labor Research. Our main aim is to keep the initiative, to keep the attention on the labor problems starting from Turkey, Britain, Europe, whole world. We started organizing monthly seminars on certain key labor issues. Just last Friday, we had Professor Ursula Hughes talking about the recent changes in the globalized market. But we also have some responsibilities for Turkey. The recent changes in Turkey is, for us, unheard of. We have lived through fascism of 1980 coup d'etat in Turkey. We have lived through many negativities, you may call, but this one, which we are living through since 15th of July last year, it is unheard of. We are faced with a situation where law doesn't matter anything at all. We don't have any law to limit the authority of the leaders. We are being converted into a autocratic state. Turkish state is converting itself into a autocratic state which regards no law at all. So we have thought that our colleagues, Önder Özkalıpçı, associated professor from Switzerland, and Edel Hughes from University of East London, and Dr. Mehmet Kurt from Queen Mary's, tell us about what they know about what is happening in Turkey. So I don't have to talk very much about the details, because what they tell us will be quite explanatory. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Ismail. We're going to start this event with Associate Professor Demos Özkalıpçı. Did I pronounce it correctly? He's a scientist, if I can understand from what Ismail said and what is on the poster here. He's an Associate Professor of Forensic Medicine and a representative of Human Rights Foundation of Turkey in Geneva and Switzerland. He will talk for about half an hour, and then we're going to collect questions from the floor. You want to use the PowerPoint.
Yes.
I think we have a problem with the screen. Although this can be seen here, I logged in with my details, so we can use this, but there is no screen here. So we have to be kind of looking at here before you
put can the website. Can I use my own laptop?
I don't know. No. I don't know how to connect the laptop now. For some reason, there is no light here on the screen. You see? Can you use that? So, okay. You can coordinate by seeing there.
Okay, let's do it.
Yeah? Move the arrows. Yeah?
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm pleased to meet you and to be part of this important discussion together with you. My name is Önderes Kalıcı. I'm a forensic physician, originally from Turkey, and I'm an associate professor of forensic medicine. My main specialty is health and human rights issues, especially I'm experienced on torture-related issues. And I worked for Human Rights Foundation of Turkey for 14 years, between 1989 to 2003. Then I worked in Switzerland, then in Denmark, 5 years as medical coordinator of International Rehabilitation Council for Victims of Torture. Then for ICRC in Kashmir, India. Now since 3 years, I'm in Geneva, and mainly doing freelance consultancies for different organizations, including United Nations Office of Office for Human Rights and other organizations. So when I'm invited for this meeting, I thought it can be interesting to speak about what's going on in Turkey. My background isn't public health, so some of the information would be very superficial. For that reason, I contacted my colleagues from Turkey, Professor Raşit Tüker, who is head of Turkish Medical Association, Professor Onur Hanzol and Professor Nilay Diler. Both of them are professors of public health. So from their studies, I copied some information. So it's a mixture of their studies and my input, actually. So I have special thanks to my colleagues from Turkey also. So this is my overview. In my speech, I will try to give some information about the health policies in the last 15 years in Turkey, especially after 2003, there is a change in health policies of the country. Then I will speak about what happened after the emergency law, and especially just before and just after the emergency law, what's the situation in the medical faculties? And also some information about Islamization of medicine again. And if you have time, I can give a few minutes of information what happened in Cizre, because I was part of the fact-finding mission to Cizre last year after the destruction of the old town and killing so many young Kurdish and Turkish young opposers who was struck inside the town. But if we have time, we can speak about it. So it's end of my presentation. Okay? So actually, changing the healthcare policies is one of the key discussions in health area and all over the world. That the privatization of the health services ideology that has big impact, and so then there's serious discussions all over the world. How can we change health systems? How can we make health systems compatible with the new economic system in the world? And Turkey, after 2003, had health transformation program. This is our Minister of Health at the moment in Turkey. And now, general studies about the country. Turkey is a 75 million population. Life expectancy is about 74. crude birth rate is 18 in 1,000, and gross national income per capita is approximately 9,500, urban population 70%, rural population 30%. And according to official figures, this is state figures actually, population below poverty line is 16%. And home ownership is around 60%, but you shouldn't compare your country with Turkey. It's a different system. Houses are more cheaper, etc. If you don't have house, you know, it doesn't. There is no other social security or support system. So having a house is one of the key aims of the any person in the country. Again, these are the official figures. Unemployment rate is 10%, and labor participation in the economy is 51%, and only 20% of the women are working. Employees without social security is about 40% in general, and in agricultural area it is 85%. Now, when we talk about the history of health system in the country, there is one, the period between 1920 to 1960. There was only preventive services. There were one of the good activities were vertical programs for selected diseases like tuberculosis, malaria, trauma, etc. For combating these kind of diseases, there some foundations founded, and with they actually worked very effectively all over the country. But generally, the hospitals were operated by the charitable foundations till 1960. After 1960, after the military coup, one of the good things that the military coup did actually, socialization of the health services law. So they had some positive impact in also in the country's health system. So then with the socialization programs, the primary healthcare units established all over the country, including the Kurdistan, including the east part of the country, and for every 5,000 people, one health care unit was established. And in these centers, okay, there's some more theory here. Actually, in the world health system, in 1978, there was an Almaty Declaration, and mainly it was in line with the Turkish health system. So establishment of primary health care units was declared as a model to all the world in 1978. At that moment, already Turkey was applying this. So it was a system for integrated approach in a small territory, and there was so many programs, including nutrition status assessment, vaccination program, family planning, food hygiene, water sanitation, and school health. In the first years of my own practice, I applied all these things in a small unit, health unit in a small village of Sakarya, which is 200 kilometers to Istanbul, actually. So health units were responsible for all those activities, like this. So you see there's minimum one medical doctor, and one or two nurses, and so many midwives. So midwives were doing home visits, and the children under five were monitored for growth, and their vaccinations were done by the midwives, and pregnant women were followed very closely by the midwives and nurses. Then after 1980, after the another military coup 1980, the neoliberal policies start to become more effective in health policy in Turkey. So then healthcare expenses became a kind of burden for the economy of the country, so they didn't want to spend so much money for healthcare services. So generally, when you look at the world, in the countries like Mexico, Brazil, Turkey, Chile, same health policies are used. So the thing is, yes, there's also private health systems in US or in UK and France, etc. But now the thing is, one size fits to all, actually. Whatever they applied in UK, can it be applied in Turkey? It's a question mark, actually. Because the strength of the insurance companies or, you know, other funds are quite different than when you compare with Turkey. The period between 1983 to 2003 can be accepted as deregulation period. So all existing systems can start to be deregulated. Then after 2003, actually, the health transformation program started. And after 2003, the Minister of Health, he said, the Minister of Health will not row the boat anymore, but will be at the helm of the ship. So, system. So, in every stage, healthcare starts to be privatized. And there was a reform on primary healthcare and finance reform and hospital reform. And the old hospitals start to behave, ordered to behave in autonomy. If the hospital doesn't bring any income, then there was a challenge. They have to bring, otherwise they have to get rid of some staff, etc. They should do more activity to be a profitable institution. In the beginning, there was primary healthcare units, but then the system changed that they established community health centers and family health units. It looks like they are doing the same thing. Community health centers for population of 30,000 and family health units for 10,000 individuals. In family health units, there were contracted family physicians or GPs. So they were private doctors. So they earn money with the number of the patient they register to their file. So if they have more patients, they would get more money. So if they make more examinations every day, they would get more money. If they order more laboratory tests, they would get more money, etc. So these family health units privatized. And community health centers also semi-privatized. So in the beginning, all control of infectious disease were done by the primary healthcare units, but now, for instance, immunization was done by one part, and diagnosing and reporting is done by the other part, etc. So the system disintegrated. And there was food control programs and food support programs done by the primary health care unit. If, for instance, a kid has a lower weight, etc., then he should get special program. He should be fed by high protein products, etc., which was free by the Minister of Health in my time in 1986, 87, 88, etc. But now, first they have to pay, and these foods also were distributed by, not by the Ministry of Health, agriculture and food organizations, and it became totally out of the control of the Ministry of Health. And again, for instance, these primary healthcare units were evaluating the forensic cases in the beginning. But now, in new system, family health centers make treatment, reporting is from another. Someone is had a traffic accident, goes to one center, gets is stitching, etc. Then for the report, he goes to another place. So, so many integration. I'll skip this. And the budgeting of the system also changed. So in the beginning, in the past, everything was covered by the state, but now the employer pays some part of it, employee pays some part of it, and some part is paid by the government. Yeah. So then, health. So the healthcare delivery from direct to changed to direct to indirect model, and healthcare provider gets his financial support from different sources, including the patient. Now, one of the key aims of the privatization reform is to privatize state hospitals and medical school hospitals. So in last, after 2003, slowly it started to get privatized, and at the moment, majority of the all big hospitals already privatized in the country. And they brought competitivity, they brought a quality assurance system, also performance-based salary. So if you don't see health of patient, then you get less salary. If you don't order more medical checks, more X-ray, more blood tests, you don't get more salary. So it's everything was related to profit, actually. And the outcomes of the reform on population health, actually there is lack of data in this context. And there are some statistics, but statistics are inaccurate. So then, these statistics are not very reliable. Another thing, health expenditures between 2002 to 2008 increased from 200 to $460 actually. And cost of curative care fall 15 times higher. Share of treatments in the expenditures increased from 40% to 53%. And as a result of this big change and unhappiness, unsatisfaction of the patients in the health system, increased violence toward health care personnel. In the past, the health care personnel had some kind of immunity and respect from the society, but because of this unsatisfaction, violence to medical health care personnel, including doctors, including nurses and other health care personnel, increased a lot. There are so many killings occurred in last 6-7 years, actually, just for simple reason. Why didn't care my grandmother? Why my grandmother died in the clinic? It really so many figures. Now, when we speak about the medical faculties, the intention is more medical faculties with more students and with limited infrastructure. There are reports that there are some medical faculties who are authorized to receive some medical students, but they, for instance, they don't have any pediatric service. They don't have any pediatrician, for instance. All right. So the quality really went down so deeply, I would say, especially in medical area, after Second World War, or during Second World War, so many experts from Germany, some Jewish Germans or German Germans, they left the country. There were three destinations for them to go: Russia, US, and third destination is Turkey. So many medical doctors, medical professors came, welcomed by the new republic, and they opened their not only medical lecturers from anthropology and social science area, they opened their departments and they work for the new Turkish Republic. So that discipline of science now it's lost actually. Turkey is more close to Far Eastern countries, I don't want to name, but I can say Afghanistan, I've been there. I can say Kashmir, I've been there. You know, the level is really goes very fast towards that direction. And figures of medical faculties, between 2002 to 2003, there were only 44 medical faculties, but now there are 85 medical faculties. And again, the number of the professors from 7,000 to 40,000. But there are still some universities working under the state, but what they do, because the aim is the privatization, they didn't make contract changes, so they are paid very low. Sometimes for 2 years, 3 years, the universities cannot get the expenses from the state. They made so many operations, they spent so many things, but they cannot get them. So they are under so much financial pressure, so then the quality of the work done in the state university hospitals also going down. Now, there's a new model, they say, a joint use model. So now, what they are trying to do, they are trying to control all the universities under the Ministry of Health, and also provide university study to all other state hospitals. And the aim is also inserting Milton stuff to all those hospitals, actually. These are the planned university hospitals. There are so many. And these hospitals will be managed by a board. And the management board should have one assistant from the Ministry of Health, assistant secretary, müsteşar, we say in Turkish, two members appointed by Ministry of Health, one rector, and two members from higher education institution. So it's totally under control of the political party in power. So luckily, there was one constitutional court decision recently. They said, universities should be independent, this law is wrong, etc. But again, with the emergency law, executive law under the emergency situation now, so they are doing whatever they want, actually. They don't listen to court decisions. Now, there is tendency to make religious health services, like stopping birth control services, campaign against curettage, women curettage, and there is a big tendency to provide halal blood and medicine, and appointing imams to hospitals, and to increase awareness about being a baby, which means prophet's medical practice, and alternative medicine, and a moral therapy for hospitals. And both a Minister of Health President opposed birth control from media openly several times. But actually everybody has right to plan and decide how many children they should have, and they have right to access relevant services, but it's not, followed. Again, for curettage, it's really very disastrous. At the moment, only 34 state hospitals have services for the consented curettage, less than 7% of the existing hospitals. And among 81 cities, only 53 of them doesn't have any curettage services. So there is really big opposing of religious rule on families and women. And already in 6 cities, there are imams appointed to hospitals for providing moral guidance services. And the plan is, at the end of 3 years, all cities, there will be appointed imams in the hospitals. And there is halal medicine activities. So mainly, there are some jails, which is can be obtained from pork, etc., etc., for covering the medicine. So it's more, I would say, a financial or economic, you know, idea. So to be more, to sell more medicine to Islam believer people, etc. So, but also this kind of activity started in the country. Campaigns against vaccination. There are two constitutional court decisions, unfortunately. They say without consent of parents, no vaccination for the children. So it's very risky, especially in an area where you are close to the Middle East, and there are war zones, and there are so many infectious diseases in Syria, in Iraq, and there are 3 million immigrants from there. And you say, oh, if the, I can understand in Europe, you know, so many infections are eliminated. So then you can try this kind of thing. But in this kind of very risky geographical zone, it's a little questionable in my opinion. And professional medicine practice, government funds some foundations, Islamic foundations, and they make so many congresses on professional medicine congress, and Minister of Health opposed this kind of congresses. So this kind of activity. And coping therapy center, they are licensed from Minister of Health, actually. And witchcraft hospitals. So maybe I can translate it very well. Cin büyüsünü bozma. Nasıl denir bilmiyorum. Something like that. So these hospitals are licensed by the Minister of Health. This is the tragic. Now, state of emergency. I don't know if I'm exceeding my time. How many minutes do I have? Some of them? 10 minutes? Okay. Now, first it was declared on 15 July, and 21st July actually, after the 15 July coup attempt. Then second extension on 15th October, and third extension on 19th January. So I don't know how many more extensions will happen, but this is already 9 months with state of emergency situation. So there are so many dismissals from public sector, dismissals from academia, justice system, army, and from closed institutions like hospitals, universities, unions, associations, and foundations. And the tendency to appoint custodians to municipalities, especially in Kurdistan, where the HDP party in power. I forgot to follow the figures, but it's totally over 45 actually. So all the weeks, the recent one had custody for the municipality. And in terms of health sector, in one night so many hospitals are closed because they were, the accusation was they were in line with this Fethullah Gülen group, those hospitals. But then, you know, there were patients staying in those hospitals taking therapy. There are so many health professionals working for those hospitals. In one night, they are without a job, even if their boss can be criminal, but they were working just, you know, and they came from any political background, and they lost their jobs. And so many health professionals lost their jobs, and access to healthcare violated again. Dismissals with executive law, these are the last figures I have, maybe it's increased, but in total, over 100,000 people dismissed, minimum 4,800 academic personnel dismissed, and among them, 300 of, four of them were the petitioners for the peace, so they made a petition for peace, and they lost their job. And actually, not only they are not losing their job, their family members, their wives, their children, loses their passport rights, so they cannot travel. I know a close friend of mine, his wife committed all her life to her children and her family. She worked in private sector, she even never went to any, you know, public demonstration in her life. But now she doesn't have passport. She cannot come and visit us, me and my family in Switzerland, for instance, because her husband was a petitioner. So this kind of really, I don't know, I just can't find words how to define this. In Minister of Health, there were 8,891 temporary dismissals. Total dismissal is now 5,500, some of them returned back. For medical doctors, in Ministry of Health, 1,565 dismissed. And in medical faculties, 1,196 dismissed from their position. So they were dismissed from public work. And also, their working in private institutions were prevented. I know so many colleagues who are working in human rights field, for instance. So generally, political police were contacting the bosses. We know this person is working for you. You should, you know, get rid of them. And they were losing their job. But now it's in gross figures, not only one or two person, thousands. So they cannot find job in private sector. They cannot find. Also, they lost their positions in the public sector. And what happens then? So many health facilities, they just offer flexible work without any social security. And the replacement of the new staff generally is with interview and with short contract system. So they say they make mulaqat and interview. So if that person is good for their ideology, they take him, etc., no fault. And also contracts are for short term, so they lost their security in working, and their passport confiscated. And in state of emergency, also gross challenges and violations and forensic examinations. Because if you think about the first weeks and months, in one night they detained 2,000 people. How can you make the medical examinations of those persons? They fill the person in the sports room, salons, gymnasiums, etc., etc., and they call one or two doctors, please make their examination. Turkish Medical Association, together with Human Rights Foundation, we work over 20 years. I don't know how many hundreds of workshops and training we did to change the system. And we were lucky to produce Istanbul Protocol, UN manual, so all the examinations should be done accordingly in consistency with Istanbul Protocol, etc., etc. They were following these rules, but after 15th of July, everything changed in one night. Even they are trained, educated person, some of those forensic doctors, because of the new situation, and there are excuses. How can you make examination of 2,000 people in one night with 5 or 10 medical doctors? Yes, you cannot. It's another dimension. So I want to stop now. If we have time, I can speak about my Cizre experience.
Yes, I think you should.
Yes, you can. You can.
Can
have, how long will it take? Because we may have questions. That's why from the floor.
Okay.
We can talk about
it. Is it?
Yes, of course.
Oh, thank you. Now, just after the, it's a very short presentation. Just I want to concentrate more on health figures. There are so many other dimensions of the, you know. Cizre massacre, I would say, minimum massacre. It's, I would, with the intentions of the genocide, actually. And but I will just try to concentrate on health figures. Now, I did autopsies of the executed persons just after the conflict. Also, a few weeks later, I've been in the region with Physicians for Human Rights. I had a chance to talk all the heads of the medical associations in the region, so many reputations and so many union activists, leaders, and so many victims, actually. And these figures that I give generally from the reports of the Turkish Medical Association. And according to Turkish Medical Association, just in Cizre Hospital, for instance, newborn figures drop to 10%. For instance, if in the past every day they were having, let's say, 20 newborns in the hospital, so it just went down to 2. Or all patient numbers dropped to 15%. If they were, the hospital was having, let's say, 100 patients every day, it just dropped to 15. During the curfew, and 46 days. All the town was surrounded by the security forces. It was impossible to leave in a normal way. Some people succeeded to leave from some tunnels, but majority couldn't leave to anywhere. So what happened to these persons, actually? If someone is expecting baby, what happened? Yeah, they made the delivery at home. If someone was sick, what happened? They tried to use whatever they had. Some health personnel stayed in the town to help to their people. So some of them received help from those people, but actually really in a very difficult circumstances, sometimes from the special passage between the houses they opened during the conflict, sometimes from tunnels, sometimes taking their life to risk, and some health personnel lost their lives. Yeah. In this hospital, it's very interesting. Now, according to international law, military forces should never use hospitals as a military position. But because Turkish security forces used Cizre Hospital as a military position, and Cizre Hospital is elevated on the hill. So from that hill, especially from second, third, fourth floor of the hospital, they can see the town much better, so they can shoot much better. So for that reason, yes, the Turkish military forces fired against the Kurds, but also young Kurds also fired against the hospital. So minimum confirmed 11 rockets were received from Kurdish side to the hospital. Minimum one security personnel died in front of the hospital, from Turkish security forces. So this is what happens during wartime, actually. But it is totally against international law. I mean, it's Turkish security forces' mistake to use that hospital as a military position, but also the Kurds has excuse, or they are firing us, so we fired them. But it's an hospital, and there are some people still receiving some health care. In also during this curfew, so many people couldn't take their routine health services, like, for instance, renal support for the, renal transfusion activities, for instance. And it can be only done in hospital, but they cannot go to hospital. So there were some images of the people with their, serum in their hand, old people trying to reach the hospital, etc., etc. When the Turkish security forces surrounded Silopi, they got the list of the patients who need medical care, and they took them from their houses directly to the hospital. So one floor were the patients, the other floor again for the military personnel. But they didn't make the same mistake in Silopi. But in Cizre, they couldn't go to hospital, so there were some losses because of this. In Silvan, I wrote wrong, again the young Kurds people put their flag in the health center, then the security force came, first changed the flag, but also they shoot to the old health center, they beaten the health personnel inside, they burned all the cars of the health unit, Silvan health unit. And there are some collateral damage to family, especially the family health centers, in which I mentioned in my speech. What is collateral damage? Now, if there is conflict or there is war situation in a city, it is impossible to not to have collateral damage. I will try to explain you. For instance, you are a NATO-trained soldier, and there is one enemy 1 kilometer away. So you have sniper. What you do? First, you look. You know the velocity of your gun. If it's Kalashnikov, M16, whatever. And you check the wind. How many kilometers per hour? 10 kilometers? 20 kilometers? Because if you shoot, let's say, this point, and the enemy is 1 kilometer away, and because of the velocity of the bullet, it will go to a target in 1 second. But in 1 second, the bullet, because of the wind, will go 3 meters aside. So then he has to shoot 3 meters before. But if he's, if the wind is from 10 kilometers to 20 kilometers, because it's not always stable, 10, 15, 20, etc., sometimes stop, so then he has to be in a secure position, then he will make it 6 meters below. And he is shooting automatic gun, then because of the tremor of the machine, then he has to make 10 minutes, etc. At then, generally, if there is a clash inside the city, several hundred meters is not secure for anybody. So if there is one enemy soldier in the other side, minimum 200-300 meters is not secure for anybody. So then there are collateral damage, including the family health centers. And looting of the health facilities, some of the health facilities were looted by the Kurdish youth. They knew that in the curfew situation, that they won't have any access to health care, so they looted whatever they can find from the health centers of the state. And there are reports that some doctors forced to drag to clash sites. Person, there were some wounded soldiers, and in the hospital there are other wounded people, but the soldiers came and said, you have to first cure our friends. So they took the hospital, and they took the doctor. Doctor resisted, and he was dragged, forcibly taken to, you know, cure their own personnel. Wounded of the ambulances stopped, and there were some volunteer doctors to go in and to give medical care, but they were not allowed. And children were not vaccinated during 4 months for it. And there were some replacements of the UMKE, translation is National Medical Rescue Teams, which they received good medical practice, but all of them were doctorized. And they said, you know, in this picture it says, health special forces. So they saw the local people as enemy. They didn't give medical, there are so many reports. Even they saw the local health personnel as enemy. So there are so many reports that they didn't provide health care. They just tried to give health care to the military personnel who are wounded during the clashes. And because of the situation, there were some volunteers I mentioned. His name is Aziz Yural. He was working for Human Rights Foundation of Turkey, Cizre Center. He volunteered to stay in the town. Then, while going from one place to another to give medical care, he was killed. Dr. Serdar Kuni, he is head of the Human Rights Foundation Cizre Center. And again, he did so many medical support to wounded people in Cizre. Now he is prisoned, and he has trial next week in Diyarbakır because of with the claim of supporting terrorist activities, but what he did only to give medical care to his own people. He's from Cizre, he's a medical doctor, he's a former head of Şırnak Medical Chamber, so if he doesn't give medical care to those people, who will give? He was head of a previous head of Şırnak Medical Chamber, I mean. Yes, thank you for your
attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think that from here. Whoever wants to ask questions, please put yourself forward.
Hello, Özgün Duman from LSE Hellenic Observatory. Thank you very much for this very informative presentation. I just have a couple of questions. Well, you defined the period of 1983 to 2003 as a deregulation.
Yes.
Period, and then afterwards, as the health transformation program started, how do you relate it with the new government, or you know, with the global challenges, especially after the 2001 economic crisis? What do you think has become influential on this paradigmatic change, or on the, let's say, on the consolidation of the health program transformation in 2003. And as a follow-up question, do you think Turkey has been influenced by the recent economic crisis? That it's, do you see any reflections on the healthcare system and the privatization program and anything after the recent economic crisis? Thank you.
Okay. Now, one thing is Turkey, so long period, is following the advices of the International Monetary Fund, IMF. It's the reason, just remember, the COVID-19 coup, after IMF made their recommendation, the Prime Minister Demirel said, oh, I cannot apply this, you know, the people can hang me. So then, okay, the exchange system, military coup, and IMF advisors and recommendations, platform. Same was for the health, actually it's IMF, International Monetary Fund advice to reduce the expenses on public sector, mainly the advice, including the health sector. So this is the key thing. You know, liberal capitalism should find its own way. This is the advice. So I'm not a, this is not my field. Maybe the other speakers can give a better response on this, but this is what I think. Secondly, if there's any impact of this recent economic crisis, we don't have figures, but I can only say what I fear. I would say yes, but we don't have really, how do you say, reliable figures at the moment. So, yeah. Everything was understood.
Okay. Other questions? Yes, I'm going to...
Actually, everything is shocking. It's not only understood, but it is the conditions of a, let me say, beginning of a civil war. Mm. If civil war happens in Turkey, we will look at Cizre just to show us the reflection of what's going to happen in all the other places. Mm. Look at Syria. So in that sense, what you told just about the medical conditions of whatever happened in the southeastern conflict zone, that is horrifying enough. And there is no law. There is no medicine, there is no medical relation at all. One side, who has the power, decides everything, isn't it?
Yeah. Maybe just one more sentence about Cizre, because it is the key thing, the massacres in the basements in Cizre, if you, any of you followed what happened in Cizre. I mean, there were, yes, some young people, but these young people actually, just like the Gezi uprising, you know, they were protesting something not without knowing anything. So they made this, how do you call it, handbag?
Dig out
holes.
Trench.
So they made this trench. And in the beginning, there are so many evidences that they were encouraged to make trench. I saw in Slopi, the police department and the distance with the trench from the main police department is not more than 30 meters. So there was no any guard in front of the police department. They didn't have any stone to throw to those young people, but they allowed to make them trenches. After that, they had some right to intervene more harshly, so then in Slopi University, they killed so many persons. Again, for the basements, there were some young fighters with some Kalashnikovs, possibly, but there were so many wounded people, and they called the television centers, they called the parliamentarians, so millions of people listened that
them that they are wounded. And they applied to European Human Rights Court, please do something, etc. For several days. There was no intervention. Medical groups wanted to intervene to give help to them. No. At the end, those basements destroyed totally. And I passed from Gizeh just a few days after to go to follow the exhumation, to follow the autopsies. When I was passing through, you know, the main road to Silopi, and a harbor passes in the middle of the Gizeh town. So you see both sides, there are so many houses are burning. So checkpoints, but you see the houses. 5 days later I returned back, houses were still burning. And how can it be? So they cleaned up, in my opinion, they cleaned up all possible evidences and they opened the town just for a few days. In the first day, some human rights defenders, together with Shebnem Korur Fincanci, who's head of Human Rights Foundation actually, she saw some child bones. And this information went to the media. The following day, they closed this town again, and with those guys, they cleaned the town. So there's no evidence, there's no investigation. The only evidence is the voice records of the, you know, trapped people in those basements. They were asking for medical help, but now, no. So this is a big humanitarian crime. Maybe 10 years later, maybe 20 years later, the responsible persons, I'm sure you'll see the jail. Yes.
Small question. Concerning the international rules, regulations, laws, whatever you call, concerning the medical standards and so on, what are your recommendations about what's happening there to the world?
But
as a sort of expert, what do you recommend the international organizations would do in medical profession, in political profession, in social professions, whatever happens there?
I don't know if I have the answer actually. This, the only thing maybe raising the humanitarian values, you know, just, you know, they have right to leave. I mean, if it was a war between Iran and Iraq, let's think, yeah, not the Kurdish opponent. So state wars, both sides are enemies, 100%. Even during Iran-Iraq war, if there was this kind of event, according to the Geneva Convention, they should have right to access health, actually. This is so clear. I mean, there is no question mark. But if someone doesn't follow it, okay. Then it's another question. It's not my area. It's more politics. So I don't.
I just have an observation. Quite interesting what you said about the post-war Turkish welfare state, the development, the post-war health provision in Turkey and so on. It follows the pattern of the West. It's not far off from what has been happening or has been. What happened in the West with the development of welfare state, you know, the Keynesian so-called, so to speak, state that was interfering in aggregate demand and, had this, the taxpayer financing the welfare state. So it was happening in Turkey in a way with the health service. And then after, in the 80s, when in the West, the welfare system began collapsing after the reforms of Thatcher and Reagan, the same was happening in Turkey. So you had one put it up being kind of pro-welfare and another put it up bringing about neoliberal reforms. It seems to me, therefore, that Turkey is fully inserted in the global political economy of the West rather than the East. So that's my first observation as a political economist, I would say. And the second, this has to do with the state of exception or emergency, which it fits the neoliberal, it facilitates neoliberal reforms, the state of emergency. It's good to have it's from a political, from an elite perspective, You know, it's far more easier to implement the neoliberal reform packages, you know, across all the sectors of the economy, if you have military kind of rule or, you know, emergency, so because you call on the state of emergency because it's legal, right? Rather than a kind of democratic participation in politics and the parliament is doing well and all this, and the trade unions, etc., etc. So the 15th July coup, it served the purposes of neoliberal cabinet in Turkey. Am I? This is just my observations and discussion points, if you like.
No, I'm not a political analyst, so maybe whatever I say can be wrong. But in my opinion, before 15th of July, Erdogan regime didn't have any strong opposition for not doing whatever he wants to do, actually. So this is more, after 15th of July, but there are two things in my individual observation. One is to have a more stronger seat, and the key thing also, they made an alliance with the former deep state, so the Kurdish, they have to go towards Kurdish problem, actually. These two things, but he mixed up those things. The economical area, already there are so many big Malaysian companies owning the biggest hospitals of Istanbul. Yes, for sure, some of the share belongs to the Prime Minister, doesn't matter, or sorry, Erdogan and his family. But the Gulf countries has investments all over the Turkey, not only Istanbul, in some cities like Rize, for instance, there are really, Gulf origin people not only owning houses and areas, but they have other investments, hotels, etc., etc. Also in West parts. I mean, it was already there. So what changed after then? It's not my capacity. I don't know. I couldn't say. Yeah.
Austerity measures in the West. Let people to suffer, and let rulers to do whatever they wanted to do. In Greece, in UK,
in France,
when even the protest came from the farmers, it didn't last.
No, of course,
the state is in the West is sort of.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. It's also fixed.
And you don't need military rule, you don't need state interference, state emergency rule.
Yeah, in 1980, in my opinion, military rule helped to shift the country. But 15th of July, I don't know. I mean, they had all the power. Actually.
Something else is happening.
I don't know.
Any other comments, guys? Questions, comments, anything? No? No? Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
You can stay here, you can participate in the discussion. We're going to have two more talks from Mehmet Kurt and Adele. Could you come and join me here if you like? Adele, you can stay here. Whatever. Yes. Adele Hughes is a senior lecturer here in the business school, in the School of Business and Law, rather. And she has a focus on Turkey in the areas of international human rights law and public international law. So she comes from a legal perspective. Dr. Mehmet Kurt is a Newton Advanced Research Fellow with the International State Crime Initiative at Queen Mary, and he is also attached to the law school. So now you're gonna hear, guys, hear the legal perspectives. So would you like to go?
Sure. Great, thanks. Hi, everyone. So this is something that I've just started working on, and the paper that I'm working on is provisionally entitled kind of Law as Weapon and the Rule of Law in Emergency Regimes. And so I've been working on Turkey for a number of years now, and most of the work that I've done was in relation to Turkey's accession to the European Union and what that meant in terms of human rights reforms kind of prompted by that process. And more recently, looking at the kind of attempts at resolving the Kurdish conflict. So I was really interested to hear what you were saying about your experiences in Cizre. And one of the things you mentioned was the fact that in Cizre there was an interlocutory kind of application to the European Court of Human Rights, which didn't really go anywhere. And so what I want to talk about in this paper, which is by no means finished, is to come back to the kind of the rule of law in states of emergency. And so what I'll do today, in the next maybe 15 minutes or so, is talk a little bit about the legal framework surrounding states of emergency. You know, some of the issues around kind of the idea of states of emergency, and thirdly, some of the kind of implications recently in Turkey for actions taken under that emergency. So, imposing a civil state of emergency is, of course, a kind of fairly typical state response to any kind of political violence, and so it's something that we see in this jurisdiction in the UK in relation to the conflict in Northern Ireland, where the UK declared a state of emergency in Northern Ireland during various periods in the 1980s and 90s, most recently, and then post the kind of 9/11 context, the UK derogated from the European Convention on Human Rights after the attacks of September 11, 2001. So the enactment of kind of emergency powers is a typical state reaction when it's kind of facing any kind of, you know, terrorist threat or political violence, threat of political violence. In the past, under the European Convention on Human Rights framework, you had, as I said, the UK, which derogated from various parts of the convention a number of times. You also had Turkey, obviously, which derogated from the convention as a result of the conflict in the southeast. And so that was kind of the sort of traditional idea, I suppose, of a state of emergency, that states will derogate from the convention for a defined period of time in order to take measures to deal with a specific threat. But following the attacks of September 11th, 2001, the kind of state of emergency, if you like, which by definition is something that you would imagine is temporary, became more kind of permanent, right? And so in the post 9/11 context, there was the suggestion that, you know, we don't know how long the threat will last. States need to take these measures in order to be able to deal with the threat and so on. So, you know, replacing the kind of emergency that is engendered by localized conflicts. In the post 9/11 world, we had this kind of global conflict, if you like. Agamben, for example, talks about the idea that, you know, the state of exception tends increasingly to appear as the dominant paradigm of government in contemporary politics. So rather than emergency being seen as something that is temporary to deal with, you know, a specific set of circumstances, it's something that becomes, you know, permanent and becomes the norm. So numerous kind of academics have talked about this idea of, you know, the exception becoming the rule, if you like. States of emergency are, you know, the idea that a state needs to resort to declaring a state of emergency is accepted as a sort of like a state's right to defend itself. But it has also been suggested that kind of declaring a state of emergency is sort of like law's attempt to control the absence of law. And so, for example, states generally tend to portray the need to declare a state of emergency as being necessary, you know, in order to take measures which will preserve liberty and freedom in the long run, right? So it's generally presented as kind of a, you know, a binary choice between security or, you know, wholehearted liberty, right, and freedoms and so on. So for example, you know, often when states take measures to deal with specific threats, right, as part of the kind of, you know, series of emergency measures, one of the things that we see is that states are generally reluctant then, when the emergency comes to an end, to give back those, or to relinquish those kind of additional powers that they've granted themselves. And so you see a seepage of emergency measures into the kind of ordinary criminal law. And so a good example, again, from this jurisdiction was, you know, in order to deal with the conflict in Northern Ireland, the erosion of the common law right to silence, for example, right, is a very a kind of obvious example, right, of how measures taken to deal with an emergency, such as you no longer have a right to remain silent when questioned by police, that then becomes part of the kind of the regular ordinary law. But the reality, of course, is that in any free society, there will be threats to security. Okay, we could probably point to maybe North Korea as being the only state that doesn't have any threats to security. And so the kind of question then that we deal with is whether or not we are willing to sort of sacrifice human rights and individual liberties on this kind of, you know, altar of the fight against terrorism. And so in the Council of Europe context, of course, which Turkey is a member of, emergencies are governed, if you like, by Article 15 of the European Convention on Human Rights. I'll just briefly read out the kind of main provisions of that article. So Article 15 says that in time of war or other public emergency threatening the life of the nation, a state party to the convention can take measures derogating from its obligations under the convention to the extent strictly required by the exigencies of the situation, and provided that these measures are not inconsistent with the state's other international legal obligations. And so a few things about that paragraph of Article 15 is that the emergency must be of a certain gravity. Okay, it must threaten the life of the nation, is the language that Article 15 uses. Also, you know, states can take measures derogating from the convention, so like suspending certain parts of the convention, to the extent strictly required by the exigencies of the situation. So that's a kind of proportionality requirement. So yes, states have the right under Article 15 to take measures, but they can only take such measures that are proportionate to the kind of aim that they're seeking to achieve with these measures. And then paragraph 2 of Article 15 says that there are certain rights of the convention that states can never derogate from. They can never suspend the application of, well, for our purposes, I suppose, Articles 2 and 3 are the most relevant. Okay, so Article 2 is the right to life, and Article 3 is the provision guaranteeing freedom from torture. So also paragraph 1 of Article 4 and Article 7 are also what we refer to as non-derogable, so states cannot derogate from these measures. And then lastly, paragraph 3 of Article 15 talks about the fact that when states are invoking their right to derogate from the convention, that they must inform the Secretary General of the Council of Europe and so on. So most recently in the European context, we have a derogation from France, and then obviously in the post-attempted coup context, a derogation from Turkey. So in November of 2015, the French authorities notified the Secretary General of the Council of Europe under Article 15 that it was derogating from the convention. It didn't specify which particular articles it was derogating from, but it referred to the, you know, terrorist attack in the Bataclan and so on that happened on the 13th of November of 2015, and said that the terrorist threat was of a lasting nature, quote, having regard to information from the intelligence services and to the international context, was what the derogation notice said. That was then extended, really, like in the Turkish context, and subsequently extended again by further 3 months, and it has now been extended up until after the presidential elections take place in July. So the emergency powers in the French context that have given rise to the derogation concern things like extended powers of house arrest by the authorities without judicial authorization. Also things like the powers of search and seizure, again without judicial review, have been extended. They have given themselves the power to dissolve organisations and groups, and also powers to block websites which are considered to glorify terrorism. Again, all of this without judicial approval, which would be the case in the normal context. So most of these powers can be exercised if the authorities have a serious reason to believe that the relevant persons are a threat to public order and security. So of course the events in Paris and then obviously subsequently in Nice and the numerous kind of terrorist attacks in Turkey remind us all that there is, of course, you know, a threat, you know, arguably to the democratic way of life and so on, that there is, you know, there are organizations, individuals, whoever, who are capable of kind of randomly striking at civilian targets. So the question in the kind of legal sphere, I suppose, is how does the law, and the law that I'm kind of looking at here is the European Convention on Human Rights, how does that kind of reconcile the imperative of national security with the protection of human rights? Okay. The European Court has dealt with, you know, numerous cases concerning Article 15 of the Convention in cases taken against Ireland, against the UK, against Turkey mainly. And it has, you know, recognised that emergency regimes, so states operating under a kind of veil of a state of emergency, if you like, does create dangers for democratic governance and human rights. And so, for example, in a case taken against Germany, the court kind of acknowledged that the effort to protect democracy may lead to actually weakening democracy, right, and potentially destroying democracy. So there are a number of kind of fairly obvious dangers of a state abusing its powers under an emergency regime. I'll mention a few here. So mainly things like, you know, when the executive confers powers on itself, there is a danger, additional powers to itself, there is a danger that this will be used to suppress political opposition. Okay, and so, it's very obvious in the Turkish context how this is playing out in terms of, if you look at, you know, the arrest and imprisonment of large numbers of HDP deputies. Or, for example, you know, the idea that individual abuses are more likely to occur in conditions of crisis, okay, where you have additional powers, significant powers, in the hands of the security services. So human rights abuses like torture, arbitrary detention, disappearances, rendition, harassment of any critique of the, or any critics of the kind of regime in power, you know, the use of power for things like house arrest and censorship and so on, all are, you know, have very kind of clear risks attached to the abuse, or the role of the abuse. And so we have seen many of these dangers materialize in the kind of post 9/11 context, in which, you know, both the UK and the US were operating under kind of, you know, states of emergency, wartime conditions. It's also, you know, becoming increasingly clear in the aftermath of the attempted coup in Turkey as well. So, for example, Amnesty International reported in January of this year that, you know, many of these abuses are being perpetrated in the Turkish context. So, for example, a report entitled Turkey's Crackdown on Human Rights, published by Amnesty in January, points to things like torture, beatings, rape and sexual abuse of detainees. They garnered evidence from lawyers, from doctors, from detention facility staff, highlighting the fact that some detainees are being held in unofficial locations. Also, some detainees, in, you know, including judges, actually, you know, in the kind of the rush to arrest everyone linked to Gulen or allegedly linked, you know, that they're being held in stress positions. They're being denied food and water and medical treatment, and so on. So, like, really kind of large scale, serious human rights abuses. And so you have these kind of very, you know, clear risks. But it is suggested that, you know, one of the most insidious dangers that is attached to the use of emergency powers is that, as O'Boyle says, regular and uncontrolled recourse to emergency powers acclimatizes both the executive and certain sectors of public opinion to their use, to the point that they are simply taken for granted, right, as a necessary evil. Okay, this may be accompanied by a steady erosion of confidence in the security forces and the rule of law on the one hand, and on the other, a growing insensitivity to the human rights issues that are inevitably associated with emergency powers, no matter how well intentioned. Okay, so in the aftermath of the attempted coup and the declaration of the state of emergency in Turkey, which, as you pointed out, has been now been extended a number of times, most recently in January, we have, you know, a situation where Turkey has invoked its right under Article 15 and derogated from the European Convention on Human Rights. As I mentioned earlier, you know, Turkey is no stranger to emergency rule, having had a state of emergency in place for 11 provinces in the southeast of the country for a 15-year period, kind of up until 2002. However, as I also mentioned, Article 15 of the Convention, you know, doesn't give states a kind of carte blanche, if you like, in terms of the restrictions that they place on rights in dealing with the perceived threat. Okay, so you have this phrase that I mentioned, that derogating measures have to be strictly required by the exigencies of the situation and also not inconsistent with the state's other international legal obligations. You also have the number of rights, the four rights that are non-derogable. Okay, so the state can never suspend the application of Articles 2, 3, 4, 1, and 7. And even when a state does derogate, the European Court of Human Rights has said on numerous occasions that this is accompanied by a European supervision. Okay, so in a case called Aksoy against Turkey from 1996, which is a very famous emergency case, Article 15 case, where the court found violation of Article 3, the torture provision, amongst other provisions. The court said that looking at all of the evidence, the effect of PKK activity in the southeast of the country had created a public emergency threatening the life of the nation. And it made this statement, which it kind of repeats in all Article 15 cases, that because of the domestic government kind of, you know, close contact with the situation, that it is the domestic government that is best placed to determine whether or not the situation warrants the declaration of a state of emergency. So the European Court of Human Rights gives states, you know, what's referred to as a wide margin of appreciation in these cases. So basically a wide discretion or leeway in terms of the national authorities determining what's necessary. However, states do not enjoy an unlimited discretion. And so one thing the court, the European Court of Human Rights, can do is look to see whether measures taken are, you know, in accordance with the, or, you know, strictly required by the exigencies of the situation, as Article 15 says. And so when the European Court is exercising this supervision, it will give appropriate weight to kind of relevant factors, like, for example, you know, the nature of the rights that are affected by the derogation, the circumstances leading up to and the duration of the emergency situation, and so on. Okay, and so in the Aksoy case, the court had said, the court said that the detention of the applicant for 14 days without judicial intervention, right, so without that being sanctioned by the judge, that this was disproportionate, okay, so that this was not something that was strictly required by the exigencies of the situation. So the effects of the state of emergency in Turkey are obviously clear, but also somebody made the point that, you know, in Turkey, the situation has, as it has kind of evolved since sort of mid-2015, it's not as if the state of emergency has, it was needed right before the state was already taking really draconian measures in terms of responding to PKK violence in particular. But what I suppose the state of emergency does, or the declaration of the state of emergency does, is that it provides a kind of, you know, veneer of legitimacy, in the sense that a state is saying that it is taking cognizance of international legal obligations like the European Convention on Human Rights, and that it's only suspending, you know, part of the convention and whatnot. However, I think, you know, there will be a slew of cases before the European Court of Human Rights concerning this period. And obviously one of the big kind of drawbacks of the European Court of Human Rights is the time that it takes for cases to kind of filter through. You know, but I think it will be like, in the same way as there's a really large body of jurisprudence detailing and looking at, you know, the actions taken in Turkey in the 1990s, there will again be a very, like, large body of case law around around this period. And, you know, I think it's the, it is this requirement that you have in Article 15 that measures taken are proportionate, right? That they are strictly required by the exigencies of the situation. That it's that I think the kind of the actions taken in Turkey by the Turkish authorities that they will sort of fall down on. I think the European Court of Human Rights is very unlikely to say, actually, the situation didn't warrant declaration of a state of emergency, because as I mentioned earlier, in these cases, it takes kind of a hands-off approach, you know, which we could easily be critical of. You know, is the supervisory mechanism of the European Court of Human Rights adequate in these situations? One of the areas that is often pointed to as being a kind of a buffer, I suppose, in terms of actions that states take in states of emergencies, is the idea that these actions can be judicially reviewed domestically as well. So, you know, before potentially going to the European Court of Human Rights. But that obviously only operates, or is only effective, in a state where you have an independent judiciary,
And I'm not sure anybody could kind of make that claim about Turkey at the moment. The European supervision, the European Court of Human Rights supervision, entails kind of close analysis of both the situation that is claimed to constitute an emergency, as well as the measures taken, right, to deal with that emergency. And so we could argue, I think, that the overly sort of deferential approach that the European Court has adopted to states in these Article 15 cases, is not particularly helpful in terms of trying to prevent human rights abuses under emergencies. And so I think it's imperative that the kind of the monitoring bodies like the European Court of Human Rights ensure that states are not kind of, you know, playing the emergency card, if you like, as a sort of kind of smokescreen for enacting like draconian legislation, often in the guise of anti-terrorist legislation, and, you know, legislation that obviously has kind of huge impact in terms of human rights abuses. And as I said earlier, that then frequently, even when the emergency is over, often remains on the kind of legislative books as part of the ordinary criminal law. Okay, so I'll stop there. Thank you.
Bill, thank you very much. I've made so many notes here. I have questions.
Yeah.
Good.
Yes, my turn. Thank you. Today I'm going to talk about the Islamist mobilization and its connection with the Kurdish question in Turkey. I was planning previously to talk about the state of emergency, but actually you already did, which is great. Now I have more space to focus on the aspect that I will be talking about. Although I work in law school, I am a sociologist, so I cannot really provide the legal aspect of the issues except from the focus of our center, which is the International State Crime Initiative. I have been working on Islamic social movements in the Middle East, beginning from my PhD, but I have recently finished my fieldwork in border towns of Southeast Turkey or Northern Kurdistan. I have worked with Islamist NGOs. I worked on them, let's say. But also I was the secretary of Human Rights Association in Sanaktar Derneği for a few years. So I would like to actually also give that account into my presentation. To start with, basically we need to differentiate between Islam and Islamism. To be more precise about our presentation. Because Islamism is a political idea, while Islam is just the name of a broader heritage of Islam, the history, civilization, knowledge, and politics, and so on and so on. We can make a slight comparison between Islam and Islamism, and Judaism and Zionism, although we can say that most of the Jews are Zionists, but most of Muslims are not really Islamists, although it gains more importance in many countries, and now we can see more association among Muslims to basically have a political identity and political association with Islamism. Islamism in Turkey or in Anatolia dates back to time of Abdulhamid, although I won't really go into historical information about the Abdulhamid period. But basically, first it appeared as a measure employed by Abdulhamid II after the independence of Balkan countries. It was a measure to keep all non-Turkish Muslim nations of Ottoman Empire together. Although it failed, and again the Ittihad and Terakki Union and Progress Party, there was another agenda that was carried and inherited by Atatürk, and for many years basically the new Turkish Republic remained a bit suspicious about the Islamic heritage, let's say. Again, Islamism appears in Turkish political sphere in late 1960s, early 1970s. And back then, basically first we see Islamism as an idea among some scholars, especially Kurdish ulema, Kurdish writers, who were able to read Arabic sources, and they were well respected by their Turkish Muslim collaborators, colleagues as well. So we can say that it's an irony, but actually Islamism was introduced to Turks by Kurdish scholars, by Kurdish mullahs and seydas. But in 1970s, we can talk about the Milli Türk Talebe Birliği as a kind of forefront, as an example of nationalist, but also Islamist organizations. Milli Türk Talebe Birliği, Turkish National Student Union. But then we see the Milli Gençlik Vakfı, the National Youth Foundation, founded by Necmettin Erbakan, even before the National Vision Movement parties. So it's interesting to see actually this kind of this parallel between the political parties and the state apparatus in civil society or in health system or in other organizations within the country to mobilize things together. The National Vision Movement, as you know, is has several parties, as Milli Selamet Partisi, Refah Partisi, Saadet Partisi, Fazilet Partisi, and they have several parties. So in 1970s, Erbakan was a technocrat, and actually he wanted to do politics within kind of the central right parties, but wasn't really given a space by Süleyman Demirel, and with the suggestion of a Sufi Nakşibendi Sheikh, then he founded the first National Vision Movement Party, Milli Selamet Partisi, I guess. And until 1980s, we do not really see a big power of Islamists within the politics, although they have mobilized a lot of organizations and civil society organizations and student unions, but they were not perfectly active. They were active, but they didn't have a big power in the politics. But after 1918 military coup, we can see after the suppression on leftist movements and oppositional parties within the country, basically Islam and Islamism was given a space to operate better within the country. And like compulsory religion classes, for example, is introduced in the education system after 1918 military coup. And apparently Islamists have benefited from the coup environment after 1918. But back then, I would argue that the political Islamists were not perfectly friendly with the market, and that's why they were not really given a big chance to operate and be very influential on masses. In 1980s, we also see the appearance of another group, which I did my PhD on, Kurdish Hezbollah. First, actually, the founders of Hezbollah appeared to be the activists and members of Milli Türk Talebe Birliği and Turkish Islamist organizations, but separated from them and founded their own organizations in 1979. Became more active in 1980s with the support of Iran, but then developed many collaborations with the Turkish state after 1990 during the civil war in northern Kurdistan. If we briefly, I basically talk about the decades. So in 1990s, we can clearly talk about the rise of Islamism. and which concerned the military elitist in the country and resulted in the 28th of February postmodern coup, which I believe that many people are not really eager to discuss this issue and how actually it affected the appearance of, or the mobilization, the appearance of the current Justice and Development Party, especially as we will later talk about it, the Erdogan regime or the AKP has benefited from it to use the discourse of victimhood a lot, and the 28th of February postmodern coup gave them a great excuse to some extent. So, and apparently in 1990s we also see the appearance of Islamic civil society organizations more than before. As in 1970s and 80s there was just few, as Milli Gençlik Vakfı, Milli Türk Talebe Birliği, or Ensar Foundation, or İlim Yayma Cemiyeti. We can just name maybe four and five. But in 1990s we can talk about İHAHA, the humanitarian relief organizations who operates in more than 130 countries at the moment, but also there are a lot of discussions about their involvement of carrying weapons from Turkish state to armed groups in Syria, Nusra, Cephet Şam, and other organizations. We can talk about the appearance of Mazlum there, although it's another case a little bit, as we consider that the two former heads of Mazlum there, Ayhan Bilgen is the spokesperson of HDP, the pro-Kurdish party, and as the other, Ömer Faruk Gergerlioğlu, was recently suspended with the one of the decrees, the emergency decrees. Özgür there is another organization that appeared in 1990s to defend the headscarf, to stand against the headscarf ban, and they were quite famous with this human chain between Europe and Asia in 1990s, although later they became kind of a tail of AKP, and they were the most organized groups to protest the issue against the siege of Aleppo by Russians and Syrians. And there are many discussions that actually the person who killed the Russian ambassador had some sort of connection with Özgür there, although it's another discussion. After 2000, so basically we can talk about the rise of neoliberal Islamism with the Justice and Development Party, market friendly. And apparently with the success or the rise of Islamic civil society organizations, with the success of Justice and Development Party, increased in numbers we cannot really count, as I try to make sense of the numbers of these organizations, but in every, even in a small city we can talk about hundreds of different civil society organizations, although we can and we should discuss that whether these organizations are really operating in our understanding of what civil society is in liberal countries. In 2000s also we can talk about some sort of freedoms in early period of Justice and Development Party, which later became an illusion for many groups within the country. In 2000 we can talk about some certain groups who started to organize. Hundreds or thousands of civil society organizations in the country, not really hierarchical but vertical and not really connected to each other, so it's hard to follow which organizations belong to which group. And as one of my interviewees once from Mazlum there, from one of the Islamic human rights organization, told me that once they were they had some visitors from civil society organizations in Diyarbakir, in Ahmet, and they visited them to collaborate on some sort of projects, and they asked them, who are you? And they said, we are like X association, I think it was Irfan or something like that. And then my informant asks them, but this is your name, but what's your affiliation? And then they say, like, well, the state calls us a Nusra. So these kind of strange connections appeared after 2000s, but especially after 2010. But the biggest part of the share actually in early 2000s went to Gulenist civil society organizations, especially in Kurdistan. We need to also talk about the Turkey-EU relationship in this regard, as the IPA agreement was released, and which allowed Turkey to benefit from a big amount of money to support civil society organizations. European Union money mainly went to these Islamic civil society organizations.
Can I stop you for a second?
Yes, please.
This room is double booked from 5 to 7. So there are 52 people waiting to come in. Nothing to do with me. It's a system. So we are going to move to second floor because this building is empty. There's no problem. You can come in.
You
can come in. Yeah. It's double booked, definitely.
Okay,
so
you can go
to the second.
It's about the legal activities as Islamism, as a political discourse, actually was against the secular regime, as they would describe it as Tawuti, which is, Tawut is a, it's a Sayyid Qutb, the Egyptian writer's description, referring, citing a verse from Quran. Means that actually the state is not governed, ruled by the Islamic rules, so it's not legitimate. So what happened that all of these organizations started to be quite eager to legalize their activities? So obviously it was the success of AK Party government, as when we look at the development of Islamist civil society organizations in the last 15 years, we can see that actually it has gone hand in hand with the political success of Islamism as well. So whenever we see the political Islam is in charge in the country, we can see that actually it follows. Also, the civil society organizations follows them. So in this regard, we can say that actually these organizations are state apparatus employed by the AK Party government. In 2010s, apparently the most important development was the clash between the AK Party government and the Gulenist after 17th of December in 2013, but even before that there was problems that people were not totally aware of. So it was actually the peak that everyone in the country became aware of what's going on between these two powers, let's say. And we can describe this period as the end of the short-term liberal period of Erdogan's dance with liberals, I would say. So after 2010, I think Erdogan has decided to mobilize, but also to unify all of these Islamic civil society organizations against the Gulenists to create kind of a balance against them. We can see. And after 2010, then we could see the new platforms, like Islamic youth platforms in the universities, the Islamic civil society organizations platforms in every city, İslami STK'lar platform, it's called in Turkish. And also after 2012, actually in 2013, a few weeks before the clash between Gülen and Erdogan, we see the appearance of the foundation of Milli İrade Platform, or the National Will Platform, as those who speak Turkish might recall. Milli İrade is a terminology used by Erdogan a lot, but more than 200 Islamist civil society organizations started to become a member of this umbrella organizations, the National Will Platform, and they started to sign declarations and show their alliances and solidarity with the government, which also became kind of a test. If you are a member of the National Will Platform, you would benefit from the state money, or you'll get the support of them. And even like if you need a signature for your organizations, for example, you want to have a private school which is supported by the government to open a private school. Like, everyone can do that. But if you are an Islamist civil society organizations and if you want to do that, you were forced to become a member of the National Will Platform, the Milli İrade Platform, so you could have like the paperwork and permissions and so on and so on. And apparently, there was several turning points in the Islamist mobilization in Turkey. One of them, I would say, after 2010 was the clash between Gülen and Erdogan, but the second one is apparently Syria and the situation of Kurdistan, Rojava, northern Kurdistan within this context. So, because, of course, we also need to discuss the termination of Kurdish peace process and how it affected this whole new collaborations and solidarities and alliances between the Kurdish Islamists and the government. Because so far I have given more account of what's happening in Turkish political sphere in general, but when it comes to Kurdistan, we can say that actually Turkey and the Turkey's way to deal with the Kurdish question, quote unquote, has always been based on some agreements, some strategies to find some contractors and allies, and basically benefit from their presence to navigate, manipulate some facts and kind of create a counterbalance against what's happening in Kurdistan. So it can be an ideological form, as in early Republican period it was the assimilation politics to basically deny the presence, the existence of Kurds, and the whole politics and policies of Turkification, which didn't really was successful. But then with the CHP, it was basically their alliance with local feodals, let's say Avars and sometimes some liberal sheikhs, and those kind of alliances to benefit from their presence in the assembly, but also to change the facts in the crown. And apparently there was some other, let's say, the state tools like village guard system and so on and so on. But we can argue that religion, Islam, was always one of the strongest tools to affect Kurdish people in terms of their notion of belonging, nationhood, citizenship, identity, and belief, and religion, of course. And of course, this promotion of Islam was based on the notion of Ummah, which describes an imaginary nation of all Muslims equal, like a thumb, let's say. What's tarak in English? tambur, something
com.
Like that.
Com.
Yeah, yeah. So it's hadith basically. It's like the all members of Islam are equal as a com, as a com. Anyways, so like this promotion of ummah and claiming that all Muslims are equal was successful among Kurds because Muslims in the country were suppressed as Kurds, although not with the same intensity, for a long time. And although Islamism as an oppositional group was quite successful in terms of some of their arguments to oppose against the regime, but for the first time after AK Party government came into charge, there was a real test for Islamism on how to deal with the Kurdish issue, as there is a real issue there, and basically there was an opportunity for Islamism to really show that the discourse they have been benefiting from to promote equality among Kurdish and Turkish Muslims is real. But from now we can say that it has failed, actually. And the biggest failure actually for many Kurds was Erdogan's position during the siege of Kobani by ISIS, because there was a clear indicator that Erdogan allied and supported Daesh, ISIS, and Nusra, and Jabhat al-Sham, and other organizations, and he preferred them to Kurds, and Kurds have felt this quite clearly. So we can say that this small Kurdish town that many Kurds also didn't know about became kind of a symbol for many Kurds, as in one short video, once I saw this Iranian Kurds, as we Kurds would say, Eastern Kurdistan, he had this short video from Kobani border on the Turkish side, and there was tear gas and water cannons, and people are escaping from the police and special forces. And he was saying, I'm coming from Iranian Kurdistan and I'm standing on the border of Turkey and Syria, and which means that actually the borders have built between Kurds in the last 150 years now have no importance. And now we can say that we are entering another stage of fading borders, that there is another stage for Kurds. But apparently Erdogan's regime has been benefiting from the religiosity among Kurds a lot, as in the last few years we can see that there are maybe like hundreds of different events in every single city, every year, every month, promoting some sort of Islamic value or Islamism among Kurds. And before there was the presence of some Islamist civil society organizations like İHA or Ensar or İlim Yayma or some local Hezbollah affiliated civil society organizations in big Kurdish cities like Ahmet or Batman or Van or Mardin. But now we can see that actually now we can see these organizations in every single city, in every single town, and they are quite actually present. While there is a big suppression after the military coup, we can see the closure of all these liberal or pro-Kurdish, pro-HDP, pro-PKK, NGOs, civil society organizations, TV channels, and all sorts of institutions. We can now see that Hezbollah affiliated NGOs are gaining more power. İHA, Ensar, İlim Yayma, and several other Turkish Islamist NGOs now are opening these dormitories for students
housing opportunities, classes, conferences in the universities, and apparently all these universities are kind of occupied by some Islamist groups, this or another. So like in Turkey, for example, if we talk about Ankara, Yıldırım Bayezid University, it's a Nakşibendi Menzil Group run university. If we talk about Bingöl University, where I worked for a few years, it was kind of it was previously Gülen, but then it became another group of Nur movement, what they are called, Kırkıncı group. So basically we can claim that the whole public sphere is occupied by Islamist groups in the form of NGOs, civil society organizations, political parties, initiatives, platforms, some well-known individuals, and of course some local, what they are called, kanaat önderi. This was a terminology produced by Gülenist previously, but now kind of AK Party supporters also use it. But after all, I think the presence of all of these Islamist civil society organizations and Kurdish people's participation in their activities do not really show that their presence will stay in the area longer, because it's kind of a collaboration based on mutual benefits. As if you become member of one of these civil society organizations, if you show up there and basically if you be present in their activities, you know that you will get a promotion, you will get a position. If you do business, you will get a contract from the government or semi-government institutions and so on and so on. But on the other hand, I think although the Turkish Islamist civil society organizations won't be successful, we can definitely talk about the rise of Kurdish Islamists as Hezbollah and also as the groups that separated from Hezbollah and became more radical and supported ISIS and Nusra and other groups are now becoming more present and visible in their activities and presence in northern Kurdistan. I'm happy to answer your questions, because I can talk about this for hours. So thank you very much. I will stop now.
Thanks, Mehmet. So it's kind of sociological, political perspective and the legal perspective. It's fantastic. Yes, Mustafa has a question.
I mean, while you were talking, it came to my mind. Initially, you said that Kurdish scholar, mullahs and ulemas, influenced the Turkish Islamism.
Yeah.
Beginning, I think you are referring to Saidi Kurli.
He's one of them, yeah.
He's one of them, yeah, that period, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Then...
But later in 1960s also.
I'm going to come there. Then Kurdish nationalist movement rise at the end of the 60s. Then from 1980s it has sparkled, sort of. How much Kurdish ulemas, mullahs, influenced the Kurdish freedom movement, if there was any. And recently you just said that that Turkish-oriented Islamist organizations are quite active in the area, Kurdish area, northern Kurdistan. Whether they are influential on Kurdish freedom movement or not, how influential? That's the first question to you. It's really triggering something in my mind. To you, then, I'm from Turkey, I know the facts of the Turkey. And I've been living in Europe quite a while. In a way, when we are talking about human rights issues, state interference to people's life, we are becoming a little bit selective. After Paris attack, a small town of Belgium called Verviers, we heard police raided one house and three dead bodies came out. And it was amazing news for me because I know the area, and nothing came afterwards. No news in the national or international media. We did not hear anything about that incident. What we learned later on, they were sort of affiliated to ISIS or ISIS-related organization in Europe. But when the police raided the house, none of the European Convention, Human Rights Convention, were considered as a matter. And it was happened, when was it? 2015. Not in the 1970s as it happened in Ireland, Northern Ireland, but 2015. Then Nice attack happened, and Muslim civilization became target. And nobody talked about their right, human right, and that aspect. That is a question mark in my mind. What is happening in Cizre, in the basement? Over 150 people burned to death in that area, Cizre, Sulopi, and Nusaybin, and three people killed in Mervia, next to the, just I think 100 kilometers away from Brussels, heart of the Europe, European capital. This is a bit question mark in my mind.
Should we answer? Or
yeah, you can answer, yes.
Yeah, I'm not sure whether I got the second part of your question clearly, but I will try to reply, and if you're not satisfied, just ask again, sorry. We can talk about like few figures in early PKK period who supported the movement. So, but the reason is clearly because the PKK stand against religions, mullahs and sayyidahs and avas, and considering them as the representative of the power that they are against, to they are challenging and dismantling. But as you know, in mid 1990s, this fact has changed, and after the PKK became kind of grassroots movements among the Kurds, but also after they changed their stand against religion and became more welcoming, let's say. So at the moment we can talk about many organizations who have another perspective on Kurdish liberation movement and their connection with religion. First of all is there is a trade union within KESK, which is a leftist union, the trade union federation, let's say. DİVES is Diyanet ve Vakıf Emekçileri Sendikası, but I would like to call them the revolutionary imams. So these are the pro-Kurdish movement imams who work in Diyanet, actually. There is also Democratic Islam Congress, founded after Abdullah Öcalan's suggestion. They had two national meetings, but with the conflict and the war, I'm not sure whether they are functional anymore.
There is Azadi movement. Azadi follows the phrase of the Azadi movement in Harar rebellion in 1927, as they say, but it's quite like religious, but also Kurdistani, which is a new combination that actually gained more power among Kurds. And there is also the peace imams and also the Civil Friday prayer imams who have their own associations in several cities. So we can now talk about actually these religious figures and scholars supporting the Kurdish movement more and more in Turkey. When it comes to Rojava, actually, one of the main mobilizer or the main power in Rojava Kurdish movement is actually the Ghaznavi family, Ghaznavi Nakhshbandi family based in Tel Maruf, the village of Tel Maruf and Tel Urfan, which is in Tel Maruf is just the south of Nusaybin. It's a small village of Kamishlo, but the Sheikh of Ghaznavis moved there from Bitlis. And it's the second biggest Naqshbandi order, Sufi order in Syria. And even the highest religious authority, Sheikh al-Islam of Syria, Ahmed Keftaro, was a Naqshbandi following Ghaznavis. So Ghaznavi's involvement in Kurdish liberation movement in Rojava is quite strong, actually, especially after the Kamishlo revolt in 2004. But probably we can talk about this in many details. I quite know this group, but there isn't any study about them. I think, especially towards the June 7 election, HDP managed to gain the support of religious Kurds more than ever, which is quite important and I think frightened the AK Party government, which they didn't really expect to see this, because for the first time religious Kurds made peace with the Kurdish liberation movement in masses, I would say. So there was indicators like from mid-1990s, but for the first time in 2015, you could see that actually the religious Kurds made peace with the Kurdish Liberation Movement and they supported them. So the 10% threshold in the election was passed quite easily. And of course, Erdogan's mindset didn't work really with the way he was planning, and I would say that actually it was the harsh measurement in the area and the civil war and the conflict is a result of this, but also it's the result of the state fear to see that there is some sort of collaboration or unity between among Kurds, whether they are liberal or leftist or religious or Christian or Yazidi or whatever in the country. I'm not sure whether it's...
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I think what you're getting at is the sort of the imperfect nature of the human rights law framework, yeah? I mean, I'm not familiar with the example that you use from Belgium, but what I would say is that, you know, very few human rights protected by the European Convention are absolute rights, in the sense that even the right to life, which would be the relevant right in your example, you know, it's not an absolute right in the sense that the Article 2, which protects the right, lists a series of circumstances in which, you know, state forces can take life, right, and it won't be considered to be in violation of the article.
Wasn't any state emergency law in Belgium at that time.
Yeah, no, but
it
just, that doesn't matter though.
Oh,
I mean,
okay.
This, yeah, so this is just in you know, ordinary times, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a good example is the killing of
John Charles de Menezes in Stockwell tube station after the July 7th, 2005 bombings. I mean, the European Court of Human Rights ruled on that case last year. His cousin took a case arguing a violation of Article 2, which is the right to life. But the European Court found that, you know, it hadn't been violated. So, I mean, it's, you know, I mean, apart from Article 3 in the European Convention on Human Rights, which is the freedom from torture provision, none of the other rights are what you would call really absolute, like in the sense that they all either have some limitations in the text or they can be derogated from, let's say.
It should then that afterwards you can ask a question.
That's a very cynical approach, but yeah.
I am personally not a friend of any religion at all, respecting all the others' ideas and beliefs. I am mostly interested in what is going to be the future of a national and democratic and secular society in the area of Kurds and Turks, given the information you gave us. How do you see the future of a secular and democratic development among Turks, among Kurds, or all of them? Accepting that some part of society in Turkey supports Gülen movement, whatever you say, I say. Some part of society support Salafis, who are in power now. And quite a big minority are seculars like me. And we have to live in a secular and democratic society, I believe. But what? How do you see the future?
Well, I think this is the question that everyone wants to know the answer. What will happen to Turkey? I mean, it's for me, it's very clear that AK Parti's hope and plan for Turkey is turning the country into kind of a semi Islamic country, let's say. They cannot really dismantle and restructure the whole country, as you said. The Turkish history doesn't really allow that, as it has been quite secular in the last century, like since its foundation. So the foundational ground is quite secular, but with the referendum, probably we will see the direction a little bit. But for the Kurdish society, I would say most of the Kurdish society, although we can talk about some sort of social conservatism, they are not that religious anymore, especially with the displacement of millions of people in the 1990s. The society and the nature of society has changed a lot. So now this political discourse saying, like, you know, my Kurdish brother is religious, it's not really. I mean, if you look at the consumption of alcohol, if you look at the people's lifestyles, if you look at, I don't know, if you observe the ground, I cannot really tell that Kurdish people are that religious anymore. Although there are some sort of, let's say, conservatism in the country, but that comes from traditions more than religion, I would argue.
Can I just ask a follow-up question? Like, could you say in a way that Turkey's model of secularism has facilitated the rise of AKP? So, I mean, many people would suggest that the Turkish model, you know, following the French model, it's an illiberal form of secularism. And so they, you know, AKP and their predecessors were kind of deserving of sympathy or elicited sympathy because they were viewed as being kind of exiles from the public sphere.
Yeah, apparently, I think we can say that.
So the AKP and their predecessors. Like when we talk about 28th of February, postmodern coup, that was actually I meant. So we need to confront many issues in terms of the Islamist politics, and but also the France imported laicism as well, which also caused a lot of troubles in the country by putting a lot of pressure on religious people from countryside, doesn't really allow them to gain any access in politics, but also in all sort of institutions and power balances in the country, which resulted in the current issue. Not maybe, this is not the only reason, but this is one of the main reasons that actually led to the rise of Islamist politics in the country. As many people saw, it was like, during all elections, people will talk about Turkish citizens or Turkish people are always have an empathy for victims, and I think the AK Party governments have used this for their benefits a lot. But in early 2000s, we could talk that Turkey was a model to promote kind of a liberal, moderate Islam for the rest of the Middle East, for the Islamic countries. I'm not sure whether we can say this anymore, considering their alliance with all these crazy jihadis, literally supporting, I don't know, al-Nusra now in al-Bab and in surrounding areas, and Jabhat al-Sham and some other organizations in Idlib and other areas. So this is one thing. And also, I am quite aware of the AK Party governments and their representatives and their politicians meetings with these extremist groups all around the country in the last 5-10 years. And with some other signals, I would say, like the visits of the head of intelligence service, what's his name, Fidan, Hakan Fidan, and Genelkurmay Başkan, what was his name? That's surprising. Yeah, visiting this Islamist scholar in his house and all of these issues. So I would say that Turkey is not really a model for moderate, liberal, but also Muslim country. Because like in 1990s, when you would talk to an Islamist, or when you read an article or an opinion piece written by an Islamist who is now a politician or I don't know, have some high positions in any institutions, you would see that they would be against, for example, Diyanet, the Presidency of Religious Affairs. They would be against, I don't know, whatever they are for now, they were against it in 1990s. And that's quite surprising to see this shift. Like they were against Diyanet, they were saying that the religion cannot be run by the state-appointed imams and it cannot be institutionalized within a state in a liberal sense or in a secular sense. And now basically Erdogan is offering his helicopter and private airplane to the president of religious affairs, Mehmet Görmez. So then we can say that actually the issue was gaining power. So.
Yeah.
After they gained power now, they don't really mind whether they collaborated with liberals in early 2000s, whether there are some liberal people, secular people living in the country. I don't think they really care. Yes, yes, Mr.
Thanks very much. I'd like to thank you for this very informative two presentations. I have two questions, one to add up, that one is to Mehmet.
your point about declaring a state of emergency to control the absence of law. When we look at that one, my question is, can we say if, considering the recent attempt to change the constitution as well, can we say if an absence was created deliberately and now attempted to fill with something? My first question is that. And the second question to Mehmet. While explaining Erdogan's ideology, you rightly used many terms such as Islamist, neo-Islamist, neoliberal. When we look at this market-oriented or market-friendly, as you said, Islamism, can we talk about political economy of Islamism in Turkey? Mm-hmm. These two questions.
Okay. So I think the quote is like the use of law to control the absence of law. So it's kind of contradictory. And your point is when the absence of law is created deliberately?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Considering this recent coup attempt as well.
Yeah, I'm not sure I can answer that actually. It's a really great question. I mean, I'm not sure it makes a difference in a way. I mean, like one of the things I was saying earlier was that in a way, you know, if you look at sort of actions that have been taken in Turkey over the last, say, you know, 2 years, some of these have happened under a state of emergency, have happened, you know, what happened in Cizre, for example. I mean, you can have a state operating under a de facto state of emergency, but not have declared a state of emergency. And then for years in areas in the Kurdish region, you had situations that were not a declared state of emergency, but which were, you know, closed military zones, which effectively amount to the same thing, right? There's no judicial oversight of actions taken by the state. And so the point that I was making about the, like, declaring a state of emergency suggests to the outside world that the state is cognizant of the fact that it is bound by, say, something like the European Convention on Human Rights or the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. But actually, it's not behaving in a way that suggests it's bound. And so by declaring a state of emergency, my point was that it's trying to create this veneer of legitimacy, because this suggests that it is cognizant of the fact that it's bound by something like the ECHR, but in actual fact, the way it operates does not suggest that at all. I don't know if that makes any sense.
Yes, we can definitely talk about the political economy of Islamism. But again, here we cannot really talk about the Islamization of economy with Islamists, but we can talk about actually economization of Islam with the Islamists. At the core of it, there is nothing to do with there is nothing Islamic about the activities. Or, like, let's talk about Islamic banks as Islam is against the interest, for example. But they would just create another name within the banking system, and they would charge you more, and just like you rest assured that you are not having, like, you're just like doing an Islamic finance, but actually paying more interest or gaining more interest. We can talk about the political economy of Islamism as today we can talk about the five-star Islamic holidays, totally segregated man and woman. We can talk about all sort of businesses. We can talk about the fashion magazines for hijabi women in the country. We can talk about the new taste, half and half mixture of an illusion to think that you are kind of a grand or the offspring of Ottomans or something, so like this big figure furniture and and the housing systems and the construction and like in all levels of society and economy, we can talk about like this Islamic makeup, I would say. But in the sense, at the core of it, there is nothing Islamic about it. I remember before 2000s, there was many congresses and conferences and panels to talk about the Islamic economy, for example, inviting many scholars from different countries, which now happens, but one of them I really wanted to attend, it was in Necmettin Erbakan University in Konya, just I wanted to see who is attending there, and there was, it was a mutual project by some Gulf countries, I think it was Bahrain, a university from Bahrain and Necmettin Erbakan University. And it was about the Islamic economy, but the participation fee was 500 euro. So yeah, at the end I can say that Islamism has created a big portion in the finance system, in the constructions, in the, but most of it is consumerist. It's nothing really new.
And it's a neoliberal policy, but to appeal to the people from a populist perspective, Islamism is being, as you said, make up.
Yeah, definitely. You can say that. Yeah, and we can say it's neoliberal, but it's not totally neoliberal, really. It's just following the neoliberal route, but it's not producing anything. It's just consuming it with a new makeup. So, and like in this sense, the gap between Saudi Arabia and Turkey is just like closing, I would say, because what they are doing there is now in Turkey is more or less the same.
Of course, go ahead. Just regarding human rights, for instance, I am thinking now there's a kind of a weakened part of human rights in this case when you talk about Turkey, because you mentioned regarding different kind of Muslim kind of say Muslim organizations, so. Is it time to start thinking human rights according to the country itself, instead of the human rights to apply, let's say we use in Europe, to apply across the board everywhere?
Yeah, so that's a debate that's been happening in human rights for centuries, actually. Like this whole idea of whether or not the human rights system is something that's Western imposed, right? Or if you talk about what you're saying, like you use this phrase cultural relativism, right? So that you have a claim to universalism that is usually put forward by Western kind of theorists, versus the idea that, you know, we should be thinking about rights in a way that is culturally relativist. So the application of rights relative to the country specific, the specific country in which you're talking about. So for example, things like say like inheritance and, you know, the Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women as applied in Saudi Arabia under Sharia law that has different rules for, say, like how women inherit property and so on. So yeah, so I mean that's, you know, an ongoing debate in kind of international human rights law.
Yeah, because otherwise I can't see the solution to Turkey. It's not just Turkey, across Africa, because even in my country it's something. I can't see the solution here, because human rights, yes, it's a good law. It's a way of, I think the principle is good, fantastic. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you can use it for your own advantage. For example, as the gentleman said, it might not create the situation, but if the situation has been created, so you can just apply it straight away. So, oh, this is, okay, I'm going to put a state of emergency, then to get away with a lot of things. So it's very difficult for anyone to say, no, stop here. For example, it's called Turkey. It's very difficult to say stop here, because the only powerful voice is the president. And then that's it. and then you, even the European Union cannot do anything, because you need some evidence, you need some real evidence. But who is going to stand for evidence? For example, this kind of meeting, for example, we have here. For example, the gentleman mentioned he's not in Turkey. He cannot get a proper insight. He has to collaborate with people over there. They cannot travel. So there's something. So there's a kind of there's a problem now with the human rights, and then to the state of emergency way, we should be thinking how we go about it, because otherwise, there's no.
I don't think it's really the evidence gathering that's the problem. I mean, Turkey, for example, has a really vibrant civil society. I think the problem with human rights generally, and you know, thinking about human rights as legally enforceable obligations for states, is that there is no kind of follow-up if states violate human rights. So, for example, the European Court of Human Rights does not have an enforcement mechanism, right, in the same way that the European Union has the Commission who will, you know, fine states who violate aspects of EU law, but that isn't the case for the human rights framework.
Okay. Can I make a comment? I mean, it's not my area, and the question was to you, but I feel like it's not a human rights issue. I'm not a legal expert, so maybe you can also comment on. It's more diplomacy. I mean, so there's a magic sentence. Let's keep the doors open for any country. For instance, Philippines. Now, every day in Philippines now, minimum 30-35% executed because of the drug war. And it's extrajudicial execution, but none of the most democratic countries has strong stand against it, because now there is a problem of China. They are building islands, etc., military islands. So Philippines is a close ally to, you know, stop China, somebody in that, etc. So, you know, same goes with Turkey. I mean, after so many human rights violences, but then, we have 3 million refugees, okay? So be good friends with us, otherwise we will send them to Europe. So, I mean, is it challenge of human rights, or is it diplomacy? I don't know. I wonder your comments.
It
is more or less the same question. There is something in reality which I can define as ruling by mob. They are organizing mobs against Jews in 1930s Hitler Germany.
Turkey.
And nobody in Europe stopped it, because diplomatically they may be criticized, but nobody said, human rights, where are they? Now, this president and whoever he governs in the state are using mobs to rule. If you criticize too much, then a mob suddenly comes, hundreds of people start burning the shops, start attacking you, attacking Alevis, attacking communists or whoever they think, Kurds. It is ruling by mob. It is a sort of gang organization which is in the state apparatus. And nobody can say stop. I believe that international intervention can't do anything. It is the responsibility of Turkish people to say, stop it. Now, we have a referendum in 16th of April, which will, as you have pointed, which will say which way Turkey is going to go. Either it will be a place where the president, no judiciary, no parliament, no executive independently checking each other. There will be one monolithic organization. He says, well, it is Ottomans were like this, and there is no elected, the elections will not carry any importance at all after that, because it gives the authority to appointed leaders, appointed. So that is in itself a system of rules. There is a rule of law, you may say, in that, because there will be some rules you have to follow. But it has nothing to do with democracy, of course.
Yeah, I think that's, I mean, you can make a distinction between rule by law and rule of law. But I mean, I think like your comments and, you know, maybe the question in relation to diplomacy as well, I mean, it's, they're all pointing to the weakness of the international human rights law framework, right? I mean, you know, states willingly sign up to various commitments, enforcement mechanisms, as I was saying, for human rights violations are weak, right? And it's up to, I mean, I completely take your point about sort of, it's up to people in Turkey to kind of say, look, enough's enough, and mobilize resistance internally. But if we're thinking about the international law generally, not just international human rights law, it's up to sort of states to kind of pressure other states through diplomacy, right? Because that's the only way in which it can be done, really. Or the alternative, you know, through like not trading with states because of their human rights record and so on. And we know that that doesn't ever happen. If you look at Saudi Arabia and, you know, the UK's relationship in terms of military spending,
Israel, and
so on.
We know that.
Yeah.
It works months in the 90s with South Africa.
Yeah, sanctions. But again, it's economic sanctions that that sort of probably are effective rather than kind of, you know.
Boycott.
Yeah. Yeah, or even like the BDS movement now, yeah.
Adele, I have some thoughts about
the
paper. I know that. There's somebody else coming, actually, for the seminar. You'll see in a minute. I was fascinated by your presentation. I worked on something similar, but from a political economy perspective. Particularly, I'm looking at the German or the liberal movement, which was an alternative to Hitler, a well-defined set of institutional norms to be imposed on the free market economy to work better and deter crisis in the capitalist free market system. Well, they didn't make it, you know, compared to Hitler. You know, as human power, but they actually became very much very influential after the Second World War, and the kind of research I'm doing at the moment, they show how they implanted the old liberal principles into the European economy. It works in a kind of, the conflation between economics and politics, that's what it is about. And this creates a state of emergency from an economic perspective. Look what's happening to Greece, the fiscal compact in the European Union, etc., etc. It is a state of emergency in a way, because if you don't do what we tell you to do, then you're expelled, you're out of the system. So what's that is coming? Now, come in. Now, I want to come to the crux of the matter you said about exception. The exception, the capitalist state has always provided for exception. So exception is not out with the boundaries of the capitalist state, right? Mm-hmm. For example, the Weimar Republic, with Hitler, the Article 48, is something similar to the Article 15 you mentioned. The European Union is a capitalist construction, after all. So it provided for its own Weimar clause, Article 15. The problem I have with this approach is that although Hitler had a state and a constitution, the Council of Europe is not a state. There are 27 different sovereign states there, that they said they have the European Convention on Human Rights, and each of them have a different interpretation. Now, if we accept Schmitt's definition of sovereignty, he would define the exception. Why should Turkey care whether the European Court of Human Rights says, you know, I want to derogate from Article 15? And then the judges there, they sit around and they say, okay, Turkey must have a point because her national security is not compatible with the human rights at the moment. Do you see what I'm trying to say? Same applies to France. But in fact, I want your take on that because it's at the crux of your paper. European Union is not a state. So you have some bureaucrats and judges and they say, oh, the European Union, here it is. The case with Mendes in Stockwell, it was not a human rights issue. Or somebody loses his children, Article 8, the family, the right to family, who gives a damn, you know? Somebody abducts a child, goes, it's not a human right. So there is no substance in the Council of Europe and in the European Convention of Human Rights because they're not upheld, these rules, by a federal state. Mm. You see what I'm trying to say?
So one clarification before I answer your question.
Yeah.
The European Convention on Human Rights is a document of the Council of Europe, not the European Union. So it's actually 47 member states. So
47. Even more.
Yeah, yeah. So it's not. So the European Convention on Human Rights is actually separate from the European Union. They're not connected.
I think there are too many sovereignties there. So who is the sovereign? My problem comes from who has, or who applies the exception. The exception is applied by Turkey, state of emergency, and then they go, because they're members of the UN, and then they say, we have to derogate from the Article 15 because look what's happened to Turkey. So if the European Union says, we don't agree, I'm just saying, hypothetically, so what?
Mm.
What's going to happen? Yeah, Council.
See, if you're one of my students, I'd mark you down for these mistakes, confusing the EU with Council.
Yeah, Council. So what's going to happen to Turkey?
Yeah, well,
you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. But I mean, I think your question is kind of symptomatic of the trend away from internationalization and, you know, towards nationalisms. Because, you know, why does any state sign up to any international law? In the sense that it's about collectivity, being part of the global community of nation states, whatever, or regional in the European Convention context.
Mm-hmm.
This discussion is really relevant at the moment in the context as well of kind of Theresa May saying that, you know, once we're done with Brexit, we'll then leave the Council of Europe.
Yeah.
And the danger then, of course, is of contagion, right? You have countries like Russia saying, well, if the UK is going to leave the Council of Europe, so will we. But what it means in practical terms is that individuals within those states then do not have any recourse to any form of redress if the state violates their human rights. You see what I mean? So of course, it's very easy to say, well, why would Turkey care? I mean, and so the only reason it would care is if it subscribes to this notion that it's part of a collective on the international level or on the regional level. If it's, you know, taking an increasingly kind of isolationist policy, certainly if it reintroduces the death penalty, it will be expelled from the Council of Europe in any case. I don't really have an answer other than to answer it with another question, which is why do states engage in any kind of international law?
But for all sorts of economic reasons, I would say, and also for political reasons, they can engage. The thing is what do they implement from what they sign up for, you see? Or then, the point is that if we see this legal approach through the the courts and so on, etc., and then you go to the European Court of Human Rights, I don't see. I see a depoliticization of political issue, which is very much what Schmitt wanted. And Schmitt wanted the depoliticization of society and economics. So he didn't want mass participation in democracy in any of those institutions. The court system. A lot of things that happen in the court system, we don't have access to. They're secret courts. That's what's happening. We don't know what's going on. So there's no democracy. So if we're saying, if we're trying to be kind of more Democrats by saying we're more global, whereas we're nationalists, we're mainly international, we jeopardize of being even more authoritarian by proclaiming ourselves as global, whereas we're very authoritarian internally because the masses are kept out of politics. So the incompatibility between national security and human rights, it can be resolved, this tension, only by expansion of democracy at the national level. That's my answer to that. Because at the global or even European level, I'm very uncomfortable. I cannot see anything happening at this European level because there are so many states and bureaucrats not permeated by popular communities. They're not heard there. The voices, no voices are heard. Look what, how Maastricht happened, how all this is all from top-down approach. And the European Parliament has no powers. It's a talking show.
The Council of Europe is created in 1949. There wasn't state in Europe. Proper state in Europe.
Turkey is a member of the
Association. Turkey became one of the leading member.
The leading member, one of the founding member of
1949.
Yeah, so.
Afterwards, NATO created. Those are the international institutions to implement some policies.
Yes.
In Europe.
Yeah. But where is
then the European Community came up and implemented some other policies, the law, this and that. Your point is quite crucial, interesting, sovereignty. But in 1949, United States did not accept the sovereignty of any European state. United States imposed its policies to Europe, starting from 1947.
I think it's clear that an authoritarian regime can easily ignore all these regulations.
Of course. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you very much for coming along. We changed the room, etc. But it's all done.